Harry's wants you to shave with pride. It's June, and this is the Focus Group.
It's the savvy side of 9 to 5. Listen.
Bueller. Bueller. Bueller.
Laugh. And learn.
Negotiation. This is what you do in business.
This is the Focus Group with Tim Bennett.
S-T-A-U-N-C-H.
And John Nash.
Keep your clothes looking neat and clean.
We're all business.
Except when we're not.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Focus Group. Tim Bennett here, along with my good friend and co-host, John Nash, also known as the Pride Leprechaun.
Top of the pride to you, and a happy pride indeed.
June, and time for happy
okay.
pride.
Okay.
What?
So Garrett's right.
Your shirt's wrinkled?
I was so worried about the pattern doing something, but you could barely see that, but you can see the wrinkles running, because it was a... I had the shirt done, and it was folded.
We got Garrett and Steve in the booth joining us for the kickoff of Pride Month. Hello, boys.
Happy Pride.
Happy Pride.
Happy wrinkly Pride.
Look at your happy Pride.
Happy.
Toss happy Pride.
Be sure to head over to focusgroupradio.com. Click on any of the icons that are there if you want to support our sponsors, as well as checking out all of our past and current audio and video shows and all the various platforms. We're also on Spotify, which I tried this weekend, by the way.
Did you really?
I use Spotify.
Did you get a free trial or something? Yeah. Or?
I like it.
For music?
You know, I'm not an app guy. I don't like apps. But you and Mahoney have convinced me I've got to get on the app bandwagon.
Get on the app bandwagon?
As if it's something new.
If you have a phone or an iPad, you better be on the bandwagon.
I have a quick question for you, John, before we get into the show. Do you know how to get a urine sample for a dog? I have to take my dog to the vet. How do you do it?
Whoa, are you serious?
Yeah.
No, I was just kidding.
Oh, yeah. I can't figure out. I mean, how would you get a urine sample from a dog? Does anyone know?
Call us. It would seem like you just got to wait for it to go and hold something under there to catch it.
She squats. She's a little girl.
And they'd run away if you try, too.
Right.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So the vet, she has some bladder issues, and the vet's like, well, bring me a urine sample.
You know those water bottles they have for dogs where it's a water bottle and it's attached to like a little thing that comes out and you squeeze the water? It's like a little cup, like maybe something like that, that's like long and thin that you could slide under and just try to catch a little. But it sounds horrendous.
Okay. So,
yeah.
I was wondering if she went on a pee pad, if I could cut the pee pad and put it in a plastic bag.
My sister's first dog, they came home one weekend and it was like a dachshund schnauzer kind of, like the dog had broken its back somehow and they took it to the vet. They did surgery, but the dog's back legs were useless. And so the dog had a cart. Remember the cart dog?
Oh, yeah, those carts.
So Laura could tell you how to get a urine sample out of a dog whose back legs aren't working.
Well, it's paralyzed. Just grab it and squeeze.
Laura had to express the dog every day, right? So yeah. So there you go, right? She had to express the dog. But your dogs are running around.
Yeah, and Trixie, but she's having, you know, she's 15 years old, and she's a puggle, and she seems to be, when she's sleeping, she doesn't realize she's urinating in her bed.
Oh, my.
Which is an issue. And I need to handle that. And this comes at a time where, and I know they're watching my friends, Brian and Rich and Kevin, their Dalmatian, only 7 years old, was fine and jumping around having a great time Monday and was put to sleep yesterday. They think he might have had an aneurysm or a stroke. It's really sad. So I wanted...
I'm sorry to hear that. Because I know you were taking care of Rex yesterday.
Yeah, I was taking care of Rex. So, and then Trixie started this issue with her bladder, so I...
I don't mean to be Mr. Debbie Downer. But when our cats began doing that, when our lives were ruled by wee-wee pads, like literally the entire apartment, when they start losing bladder control, the vet...
Someone told me there's a pill they can give them.
Well, if that's the case, but I wonder what a urine sample is going to show the vet.
Yeah,
I don't know how it relates.
Maybe if there's a bladder infection. She is the most clean, neat, patient little dog around. I mean, she's very neat. She's always she's almost like a cat. She cleans her paws. She doesn't like to get dirty necessarily. And so it's very uncharacteristic of her to mess. She never messed in the house.
Never.
So for her to mess in her bed is an issue. But anyway, I thought somebody might know how to get a urine sample. When the vet sent me that, he texted it to me, like, here's confirming your appointment, bring a urine sample.
You know, it's almost as crazy as the vet saying to you, could you provide a blood sample?
Yeah.
You know, none of us...
How do you want me to get it?
Want to send a PDF with instructions or something? I mean, it's... I think they just discharge this kind of stuff like without even thinking about it. Oh, yeah, Bennett's called in. Trixie's doing something. I haven't got a urine sample. You know what I mean? It's not like us going for a physical and doing the cup in the bathroom. I mean, it's like...
Yeah. Hey, we mentioned early on in the show in the tease that it is the start of Pride and June Pride. And we have a sponsor here joining us, Harry's Grooming Company. And if you would like to try a great product while also supporting an amazing cause, you can join Harry's. And they're dedicated to giving back during the month of Pride. They give back all year long, but particularly during Pride, they're releasing this limited edition Shave with Pride set, and 100% of the profits go to the Trevor Project. And as you are familiar with Trevor, you know that they reach over thousands and thousands of LGBTQ youth in crisis. And John and I have both been using the shave kits. We love the lather. What comes in the kits, John?
Kit comes with a one-of-a-kind iridescent handle, and truly they are one-of-a-kind because of the way they're manufactured. Lubricating strip and precision trimmer. Lathering shaving gel. Now, are you a gel? Have you been gelling, or are you?
So I usually would always do the cream, but what I like about this is it's like the best of both. It gives you the close shave of the gel, but it also foams. I like a little foam. I don't know why.
This also comes with a travel blade cover, which Bob had to explain to me. I'm like, what is this thing? He goes, that clips on, so when you throw it in your dop kit, the blade doesn't get... Yeah, exactly. I was like, oh, thanks. And the really cool thing about the Harry's kit for Pride, supporting the Trevor Project, is the box was designed by artist Jose Antonio Rota. So there's a bunch of illustrations that he did on the front and the sides. There's also, if you go to harrys.com and you look up the Pride kit, there's also a PDF you can download with some famous people talking about Pride and stuff. It's a very well done thing. We have a code for you to use if you want to try it out. Now, one thing I would say is it's harrys.com/focus, F-O-C-U-S, and I say it this way: if there's ever a month in a year to break a habit or try something new, this would be it. Because give Harry's a shot. It's a really well done kit, a wonderfully executed program, and me and Tim have seen a lot of programs done around Pride months for years now, right?
Yep.
So I think the effort they put into this is well worth your time to check out. And again, it's a beautiful kit, and it's an amazing shave. And I think it all comes down to about $2 a blade.
Right. It's great quality at factory direct prices. And as we said earlier, Harry sets aside 1% of all sales for nonprofit organizations, which include LGBTQ organizations year round. So aside from supporting the Trevor Project with a Shave with Pride kit, they also give all year round, which we always tell companies they need to do that, not just in June. So kudos to Harry's. So what's the code again, Mr. Nash?
You know what they get? They get a top of the pride to you, Harry's. Harrys.com/focus, F-O-C-U-S.
Perfect.
All right.
You got any pride things going on, Mr. Nash, that you're doing?
No, but I've noticed an influx of people. I've noticed
New York is going to be
ground zero for World Pride. I think I mentioned this last week when we... Oh, by the way, we had Keith on last week. He sat in for Tim.
I loved his purple outfit.
Yeah, his zebra vest. He was great. It was wonderful to have him sit in for you because he's one of our old OutQ family friends. And I think during that show, I brought up something that one of Bob's coworkers, a phrase he uses. He goes, oh, Bobby, you and John better get out of town. The world gays are coming. The world gays. The world gays. Yeah.
The world. Well, there's the Stonewall 50th anniversary Stonewall.
Regular New York City Pride.
And then it's called...
And there's World Pride as well. Yeah.
It's all the same time.
Yeah, you know, I think it's the third Sunday. Is it third weekend?
The last weekend.
Last weekend of the month. That's right. You can imagine all the competing parades. I don't know how they're doing that. Are they doing one day, one another? You know,
it's already long. I mean, not to begrudge the parade,
but
it's a long parade. You know, by the time they get to people who love Patsy Cline and use electricity float, you're kind of like, okay, I've seen enough.
But I'm bumped. People, gays for electricity.
Gays for Patsy Cline.
Gays for Patsy Cline.
Blue moon. Who's next? Oh, there's a Katie Lang.
Seven float. At night.
Right? Here's Ella DeGeneres.
There's one person in a lawn chair waving a flag as the gays for electricity go by.
Gays who use electricity. Here we are.
Gays who like running water.
Yay.
Gays for wind power. We're being terrible.
We are, John, and it's Pride Month. You're supposed to. Where's the leprechaun to get us back?
Happy Pride, top of the Pride to you. You know, by the way, the Pride leprechaun came out. I don't know. One year we were going to watch the parade with a bunch of friends, and I started doing that top of the Pride to you because everybody was like, "Happy Pride!" It was almost as if it was like, you know. And I mean, then I just went into this top of the Pride to you, Happy Pride, top of the Pride, and then I also came up with this thing where if they took the Christmas Carol. And they re-scripted it for, you know, there would be a mean, nasty gay who would be the Scrooge character. And he'd wake up after the three gay ghosts of Pride's past.
We all know him.
Pride present, Pride future, you know, Pride past. He throws up in the window on Christopher Street. And he looks down at a young man with, like, bulging biceps and a tight T-shirt. I say, what day is today? Why, it's Pride Day, sir. Oh, I haven't missed it. Run down And in my story, run down to the sex shop on the corner and get the biggest dildo in the window instead of the biggest turkey in the window. I was doing that. That was the Pride.
Well, I'm sure you had everybody laughing.
It was the Pride Leprechaun and the Pride Carol. And yes, everybody in our immediate that was hearing this was howling with laughter. And of course, I think we were drinking too. So,
what do you think?
Oh, what a surprise.
I don't know. I always thought saying happy Pride was queer. But it sounded queer.
That's why I went to Top of the Pride.
Top of the Pride.
Because it was like this weird thing. You'd be walking, Happy Pride. Happy Merry Christmas. Yeah, happy Pride. Yeah. Oh, Happy Pride. How was your Pride?
You want some sugar with that diabetes?
We are so bad.
We love Pride, everybody. Go and support all the Pride events in your town.
We are so bad.
What caught your eye this week, Mr. Nash?
What caught your eye? Here's what Tim and John found.
This is a kind of a toss-away technology thing. The surprising main reason 492 out of 500 people at one company chose iPhone over Android. I wonder if you guys can guess this at all. Anybody in the booth can guess?
What was the question again?
It's the surprising one reason why 492 out of 500 people at a company chose to have an iPhone over an Android phone.
I think I know.
Okay.
Because they're dumb.
Whoa, whoa, whoa! Top of the Pride. You don't get a top of the Pride for that, mister.
I was going to say design, the look.
No, no. Okay,
you
so.
Have a guess?
No, no. Steve, no.
The company they work for had a deal.
No, no.
That would make sense to me.
A Reddit, you know, this Reddit thing online, an IT worker posted to Reddit his discovery when he and his the other guys in the IT department realized one day that out of the 500 employees, 492 had iPhones. And so they did a survey within the company. The IT team was so intrigued that it decided to issue a survey to ask employees why they chose the iPhone over Android. According to the Redditor, more than half of the iPhone users of the company gave the same answers. Did they choose the Apple's iPhone over an Android handset because of the award-winning design, the build quality? Was it because iPhones always outperform even the most powerful Android flagships in real-life speed tests? Or perhaps it was because they all prefer the simplicity and ease of iOS compared to the complexities of Android? Nope, it wasn't any of that. Here's the reason. It was because they didn't want to be green bubbles. A reference to the fact that iMessage chats on iPhone, iPad, or a computer appear as blue bubbles.
Right.
So when you get a green bubble coming up on your screen, that means someone's not in your universe. They're sending a text from a different platform. They're sending it from...
I often wonder what the difference colors were.
It's coming from a non-Apple product. It's a unique thing.
I wouldn't even have thought of that, would you?
No, but it's a thing. I mean, at least to these 500 people, 492 people is... Are you guys surprised by that, or you're not surprised?
I am shocked.
I've definitely heard it before.
Oh, okay.
It's like a meme, like, you know, dissing on someone because they texted you with a green bubble.
With a green bubble, yeah. See,
but most people in that survey said that they were like, "We can't. That's insane."
They wanted iMessages and they wanted to be blue. They didn't want to be green when they sent texts. Now, this is a unique thing to the United States because we're one of the few countries that still have a very robust SMS text system. The rest of the world uses WhatsApp, Facebook Messenger, Telegram, and other messaging platforms that could be on any phone. But it's the unique thing about the United States that people still do a lot of texting, and it's through iMessages. So that was just an oddball thing to me.
Did you see, by the way, that iTunes is going away?
Yeah, thank God.
What happened? Can I keep my music?
Yes, everything will be fine.
Do I have to download anything?
Nope, you're fine. So what's going to happen is Apple broke up iTunes into music, TVs and movies, and podcasts, three separate apps. Someday when you, and I don't mean this in a detrimental way, but when you upgrade your system software, maybe in the fall or next winter, the new software will look at your iTunes library and divide it into all the different, so music will go into music. It should be easier to manage, by the way. TV and movies will go into TV and movies, and podcasts will go into...
So you can't buy things anymore.
Yes, you can. Yeah, you can still buy and download.
Well, I thought they were shutting the store down.
No. They're just getting rid of the software on the Mac side, which, frankly, is bloated, confusing, and drives me crazy. So this is a long time in coming.
And I have a Gmail question for you, too, but I have to do it offline because I can't reply to something. You set up a new email account for me,
yeah,
for Triberry, but unless I'm in the account,
in our corporate account, yeah.
I have other email addresses you've set up for me that I can reply as different people. I can't do it with the .co.
Oh, I'll talk to you about that. Okay, I know what he's talking about.
I was going to do it on the phone. I thought you'd yell at me on the phone, but on the show, he'd be nice about it. See.
See, Garrett's smiling.
Because it would be, you idiot.
I think I got the last question right, by the way.
Which one?
The why they chose the Apple phone over the Android. That was a pretty dumb reason. Can I just say?
Well, that would mean I would have to accept that they were stupid for doing that. But yeah, I could see where he's going with getting the answer right. Yeah.
You know, if there's ever a case when you're out, I'm going to have Garrett sit in because I think
No.
It'll be the two disagreeables. Right?
What do we hate?
What do we hate? We hate you all. Thanks for tuning in.
What hate your eye?
What do you hate today?
What pin got stuck in your eye? All right, well, so what was your...
Mine was... this just made my blood boil because I saw this, and I actually posted it to our Facebook page because of the hypocrisy of it. And again, as we kick off Pride, this Catholic bishop in Rhode Island...
Oh, yeah, yeah.
The Catholic bishop who ignored child sex abuse cases while he was in Pennsylvania... although he's in Rhode Island now, calls pride parades harmful for children. So this was last Saturday. Bishop Thomas Tobin, a Roman Catholic leader, who by his own admission ignored incidents of child sex abuse when they occurred in the church, tweeted the following message out to Catholics. A reminder that Catholics should not support or attend LGBTQ Pride Month events held in June. They promote a culture and encourage activities that are contrary to the Catholic faith and our morals. They're especially harmful for children. So the Huffington Post and a bunch of activists jumped all over this and said, quite frankly, I'd feel more comfortable with my kids being at a gay pride parade than at the Catholic Church.
Church, yeah.
In terms of being safe. But and then they go into how he was actually part of that Pennsylvania issue where there were over 1,000 victims which were abused by over 300 priests. He knew about it, but he didn't call the police or call any authorities because he didn't feel it was his role to do so. But there's a picture of the clown. But I put the
there's a picture of the clown.
Well, I think
you know how you feel about this.
Well, I think it's disgusting. You know, you're going to sit there. You got thousands of kids that have reported. How many do we know that happened?
And millions of dollars in settlements being paid by the church. Right,
and
right?
It's worldwide. And he's going to waste his time by tweeting out to the followers in Rhode Island that how harmful it is. And
you know, he backtracked on this.
Well, he tried to backtrack. They went and did a protest in front of his house. And but he did still say that that it was in conflict with the teachings of the church. But what other people are saying, there's an awful lot of gay people that are still devout, they're still Catholic, they still support the church. That's fine. But I don't know how you sit in pews and hear this kind of moron talk to you each week and then leave there and just say, okay, and put money in the till.
Yeah, hey, look. I remember, is it Christopher Hitchens is the, he's since passed away from cancer, but like renowned atheist, I mean, he's an author. I think he opened one of his books by saying something to the effect of, if you believe that a child could be born of a virgin birth, which has never been seen in nature, never in recorded history, animals, humans, nothing, you have to have the, you know. If you buy that, then you're on on the roller coaster, and you're going to be buying all this other stuff too. but yeah, hey, you know, the thing that amazes me is that more parishioners don't call them out on their hypocrisy and just stop coming to church.
Well, there, you know, that is happening in a lot of places, right? A lot of churches are closing. But I just thought, with all of, you're already in trouble for the child sex abuse cases that are happening everywhere. Keep your mouth shut.
Well. And expand that. You know, there was an article in The Atlantic recently where everybody thinks that all these issues with the church are just children. There are many, many documented cases of priests with parishioners, with wives.
Women,
so it's not just that. And they all covered up, and there's millions of dollars in payments.
That's crazy.
If you want to believe, you know.
So we have a call. Don in Alabama, we haven't heard from you for a while. What do you got for us?
Hi, guys. First of all, John, it's billions, not millions.
In terms of the payouts from the church?
Yeah. In total, since 86 or 87, it's a little over $1 billion now.
Wow. Oh, my God. You could put how many kids through college with that money, right?
Well, you could feed most of sub-Saharan Africa with what they've had to pay out. And now realize, in pedophile abuse settlements that have been made public, that says nothing of non-abuse, priest and parishioner issues, any of the other cases that have been settled that we don't know about. But there is one I read somewhere where the Catholic Church has sealed hundreds of thousands of litigation settlements, hundreds of thousands in the United States.
Yeah.
So, but no, what I actually called about is, what do you guys think of how you market a $50,000 brand new computer from Apple?
Listen to you, $50,000. All right.
Hey.
Can you tell us a little about it, you guys?
What Apple, is it? Apple, and Don's talking about something that Don and I would both love to probably have for its raw processing power, but they released a new Mac Pro. It's been a long time coming. The last one looked like a little garbage can, actually, like a cylinder or something. The new one looks more like a cheese grater. It has handles on top. Cost $5,000 or $6,000. You could buy a monitor, this 6K, like super high resolution monitor that goes with it. The monitor, I think, is $6,000. And the stand, when you have to have a stand to put the monitor on, is $1,000. So, Don, I think $50,000 actually, you could probably spend $50,000 if you put a couple drives in the RAM, right?
If you get the 1.5 terabyte RAM, if you get the full 24-core processor configuration, if you get the 4 terabyte SSD primary drive, you're at about $42,000, $43,000.
Wow.
Based on current industry prices for those components. You throw in the monitor. Now, in defense of the monitor, having worked in a production studio, that $6,000 monitor replaces a monitor I used once that was $47,000.
Wow.
Okay, that clarifies that for me.
So, Don, who would use a computer like this? I mean, this wouldn't be someone that's a residential user or something.
No, this is film editors, right, Don?
Well, I mean, think about it. The horsepower it takes to process 4K. Think about what it took, John, for you to render for HD, when you were taking your animation classes, just to render those sequences. You're talking about, you know, reducing rendering time to seconds rather than minutes or hours.
Wow.
But, you know, the folks that are going to line up for this, Pixar, ILM, every production animation house in the country, because this box will replace rooms full of hardware.
Don, well said and well thought out. When I was watching the live stream, I thought, who's buying this? But you are right, because they can replace swaths of hardware with this now. Wow, that's...
So this goes back to what Apple originally was, when it used to be the computer for designers.
Creative professionals. So
this really takes it back there, doesn't it?
Well, not for the masses, but yeah. And if you're a film editor or you are an animation, time is money. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if you can cut down that, and you know, Don, when I edit our show actually in Premiere, let's say, and then I have to, you can't just edit video and say save. You have to render it out.
Yeah.
We're at about, you know, for a 50-minute show, it takes about 45 minutes to re-render to generate like a 3-gig file. If you cut that down to like 10 minutes, wow. I'd buy that.
John,
yeah.
On this machine with if you get all the processors, that rendering will take place in less than a second. Because this will render 2 8K streams in real time.
Don't tell him that, Don.
In Premiere. It will render 2 8K streams simultaneously.
Stop, Don. It'll be John's next thing. You know, I was thinking.
I really need,
because this will really help save things and move things along.
I have to construct all these. I feed out these little nuggets to Tim. Like, if we had this, we could do this. If we had this, we could do that.
It was really good. I wish I had taped all the selling points for getting an iPad. That was my best. That went on for about 9 months. You can read at night. Do you like to read at night?
Tim, are you familiar with what in Apple we refer to as the swirling beach ball of death?
Yes.
Okay. In our company, we track every second that someone, or every minute someone's on a computer. And based on our tracking, our average top-end production person is spending 60 to 70 hours a year watching a beach ball spin.
Wow.
Waiting
for aggregated
process.
Over 2,088 hours. So at a billable $200 an hour, how quickly do you pay for a $20,000 computer?
Wow. Now, Don, I think you just answered your own question. How do you market this?
Yeah. Don't get me wrong. We've already got budget set aside for our first two boxes.
Wow.
Good for you.
Oh, yeah.
Well, you'll have to let us know how it works when you get it.
Well, we're going to do away with office heaters and use these instead.
Yeah, they're going to generate heat, man. Those are lots of heat.
All right. Well, thank you,
Don.
Thanks, Don.
Thanks, guys.
We have Billy. Billy's checking in. Hey, Billy.
I get a couple boxes of Crayola crayons. Does that help?
That's my speed.
That's Tim's computer. That's exactly. And you throw in an abacus, you got computing power times 10, right?
Yeah, and you can sharpen it in the back of the box. You're good to go.
I used to like that little sharpener, but I didn't like when it got to the paper.
Yeah, I like the sharpener on the. Yeah, you have to peel the paper off. Yeah.
Bill, you doing any Pride events this year?
Oh boy, am I ever! The boys. We first got slated for a 7 o'clock p.m. push off for gay pilots. Now we got up to 5 o'clock for our step off. I don't know.
Where is that in Manhattan?
Yeah, it's at the big Pride parade.
Yeah. It's like, when are we going to get home? Tuesday?
Hey, you had the same problem last year, right?
Yeah, last year I didn't do it. I just said...
The year before. It was the year before, yeah.
Yeah. They had us at, 3 or 4 o'clock. We finally rolled into the village at 7. Left at 5 o'clock. Maybe we'll get in the village about 10 or 11. God.
So they put you back. They put you back with all the professionals where we were joking about earlier, but probably not so much at this point. You know, gays use electricity. Gays who fly planes.
Patsy Cline will be in front of us with her red wagon.
Well, you'll have to let us know how it goes if you don't talk to us before, Billy. Thanks for giving us a call.
I'll try because I know Nash wants to probably go on about something. The birdcage, that's it, the birdcage.
The birthday's next, that's right. Thanks, Billy.
No, he's at birdcage.
All right.
Oh, birdcage?
Yeah, which is that classic old, it's the movie that Nathan, hey, Billy, thank you. So I just want to say that last week we played a game with Deep Discount. We gave away Blue Velvet discs. I'm going to mail out and email the winners tomorrow, actually, because I collected all the names and everything. Everybody did really well. And I may, if you're not going to get a movie, I may just send people socks.
That's a good idea.
You know, just because we can do that.
Because we got some socks.
Thanks for reminding me, Billy. Yes, and it was. And last week, the clue was the birdcage.
Cool.
And Billy got it.
Oh, so he's getting socks.
He got it,
movie and socks. So our business birthday today is in honor of you, John.
Everyone does celebrity birthday greetings, but the Focus Group is the only show in the universe that celebrates business birthdays.
What is it, my parish priest? No.
Born today, or born on this day, June 5th in 1895, he died at the age of 83 in October of 78, an American inventor known for creating the Zippo lighter, George Blaisdell.
The Zippo.
Zippo.
So you know where that was created for, right?
Well, it was based off an Australian lighter from the 30s. And George had started school, public school. He dropped down to fifth grade. And he was expelled from military school later. So at the age of 12, he went to work for his father's machine shop. He later sold it because he thought he was going to invest in stocks and oil. But he did not do well in either. So in 1932, he took the rest of his money and began importing cigarette lighters from Austria. And sales were a little sluggish, so he used his dad's machine shop skills to design a more durable and reliable lighter, and which he called the Zippo. And of course, not to be confused with the ubiquitous 99-cent lighters, the Zippos are guaranteed for life, and they can be repaired or replaced at any time free of charge if they ever fail to light. I didn't realize that. They were originally made from brass tubing with a cover to protect the flame from the wind. The lighters sold slowly until World War II.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
When Blaisdell sold Zippos by the millions to the U.S. military, he also shipped a steady supply to war correspondent Ernie Pyle, who gave the lighters a lot of publicity. After the war, soldiers that were fond of the Zippo, of course, made the Deluxe a favorite of choice. When he died in 78, he left the company to his daughter, and they still control the company, and it's still a family-run firm. And there's some other pictures. There's pictures afterwards. I laughed at
you. Can these get, are you can customizable get them customized. Zippos.
Look at the one in the middle. I got that one for Garrett. The one in, you like that one, Garrett? That popped up first. I did Zippo images. That popped up first. And then, of course, there's the Pride lighter.
Happy Pride, right next to the.
What do you think? What do you think of the middle one, boys?
She could light my fire.
Well, there was a whole, and then there's a whole line of Playboy ones, which I couldn't have shown.
Garrett, I think that that's appropriate because, you know, Zippos can light in any conditions, and frankly, if you lit something on the side, like next to her, her evident cleavage could block the wind just as well as the Zippo could. But my God,
do you guys have Zippo? Anybody have a Zippo lighter?
I had Zippo. Yeah,
I do. But they always run out when you least want them to. Yeah.
Yeah, and it was a lighter fluid. Yeah. Yeah.
I didn't like the smell of them.
Well,
that too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Did you like the smell of the Zippo? I don't know. It always.
You can't smoke other things with Zippos.
What do you mean?
Like marijuana.
Why not?
The flavor gets into it.
Yeah, the carous, it's lighter fluid.
So it doesn't affect tobacco? Yeah. Oh, I guess you have a filter on a cigarette.
With tobacco.
Tobacco,
you know,
the same too, but you're not lighting a tobacco all the time.
Yeah, you're not directly getting the flame. You light once, you're done. As opposed to if you're having something else that requires flame, like
you have to keep lighting a joint?
Well, no. That's the one thing you don't.
I don't know. I'm a cannabis neophyte.
Naive to cannabis. But yeah, Zippo was, when I briefly smoked, Greg forced me to get a Zippo because that's the cigarette lighter of choice. And he had to have that weight in his pocket. He had to have that Zippo in his pocket.
I think you gave that to us one Christmas.
Yes, we did. We actually did. Greg found these sets. It was like it came in a box and everything.
Yeah.
And I think there was a travel book with it too. Yeah.
So, hey, everybody, you know that our friends here at the Focus Group are a deep discount. Right now, they've got their site-wide summer sale.
Yeah, it's like seashells by the seashore.
It's their site-wide summer sale going on right now. If you head over to focusgroupradio.com and click on the Focus Group logo, click on the deep discount logo.
The shark,
you can start shopping away. And June's a great time, for me anyway, to help refresh or replenish a lot of my LGBTQ titles that have seemed to have gone away when I loan them and they don't come back, and deep discount can help fix it.
The Happy Pride titles.
Can remedy
Happy Pride.
That. So I picked this, let's see, you're going to go first, John.
What all right. staying in my lane of bizarre / animated or 3D films, I picked a movie called Your Name. I've been meaning to see it. It came out in 2016. Site-wide sale has it for a great price on Blu-ray. And it's
Your Name.
Yeah, it's an anime. So it was written and directed by Makoto Shinkai, released in 2016. It was the fourth highest grossing film of all time in Japan and the highest highest grossing anime Japanese film. It's won multiple awards, and it's getting a live action remake. Stunning visuals, fun story. It's one of the things that's been on my radar for a while, and I actually have it on a list of movies to try to get. But so this comes up, and I'm like, you know what? It's a site-wide.
Saying English?
It's subtitled. And actually,
want to read. You got to read it?
See? Did you see the hand? I don't want to read. That's a funny thing that you bring up, because Bob's the same way.
I want to read a movie.
If they dubbed it, he would watch it in a second flat, but he doesn't want to do the subtitling. But yeah, so it's called Your Name, and it's a anime film from 2016, and it's gotten great reviews, and it's supposed to be cool. So that was my pick.
I like the imagery, though. I think that's cool.
Oh, it even says here, even the slightly odd soundtrack from the Japanese rock band Rad Wimps, RADWIMPS, is perfect. They'll grow on you, and you'll watch the credits while Googling the band.
Well, there you go.
So there you go.
Sounds just for the soundtrack alone, yeah. John. So I picked, again, staying with the June Pride theme, To Wong Fu, Thanks for Everything, Julie Newmar.
Patrick Swayze,
Stockard Channing, Wesley Snipes, and John Leguizamo.
Leguizamo.
They kick up their heels, a trio of New York drag queens whose cross-country road trip gets interrupted when their car breaks down in the Midwest, and the residents all need some sort of makeover, and of course, hilarity ensues.
Hey, Steve, is this 96 or 90?
Well, it came out in 95.
Okay.
It came out in 95.
So you know the interesting thing about this movie, do you remember when it came out?
Yeah.
Did you go see it in the theaters, or did you wait?
No, I did not go see it in the theater.
I don't believe it was, I think the reviews were like lukewarm. There was two things happening with this movie. When this came out, a lot of the LGBT community was very upset that they couldn't have cast actual gay men or drag queens. These are all like straight actors, and they're so brave for doing it.
Right, and they were Billboard.
They were box office draws.
Box office draws, yeah. Right.
In hindsight, or now when I've seen the movie recently, and you know, it's really not bad. In fact, I think it is worth a watch, and the actors did a great job. But that was in a time period when we did not see ourselves represented quite so often on any popular. No. Yeah, so that's why it's a cool movie.
No. So,
hey, folks.
What was the release this week?
Okay, so if you're a Lost in Space fan like I am, warning, Will Robinson, warning, and Dr. Smith and the whole bit. Netflix rebooted Lost in Space in 2018. It was a big hit on the Netflix streaming platform, and in fact, season two is due in a couple of months. I'm going to tell you this. I would recommend the Netflix show. I think you'll really enjoy it, but it's not the goofball Lost in Space you grew up with. In fact, halfway through, we're binge-watching, and Bob's like, you know, I kind of miss the other Dr. Smith or the robot.
Was this very serious?
It's not bad science fiction. They took the characters, they took the premise, but they remade it, and it's not as. In fact, Parker Posey plays Dr. Smith. Not a bad casting call, but it's different. But it's enjoyable, and it was well done. So I think that if you want to pick up Lost in Space, complete first season, if you don't want to stream it, by all means, pick it up. It looks great on Blu-ray, I imagine. So Lost in Space Season 1, release of the week. All right, recapping on the site-wide summer sale. Own your passion at deep discount. Arr, the shark! I picked a movie called Your Name. It's an anime film from 2016, award-winning film, considered to be one of the greats, and it's a big, big, big box office in Japan. I know that might not sway you. Tim picked a really classic LGBT title, To Wong Fu, Thanks for Everything, Julie Newmar, in honor of Happy Pride
Happy
Month.
Pride.
Leprechauns colliding with Sharky. And the release this week is Lost in Space from Netflix, the 2018 season one on Blu-ray. What do we say, Garrett?
Thanks, Deep Discount.
All right, friends, we're going to take a little break here. And when we come back, we got two shop talks for you to go over. So stay with us. We'll be right back.
You're listening to The Focus Group with Tim and John. Learn more at focusgroupradio.com. Focus on the savvy side of 9 to 5 with The Focus Group.
Try, really try.
Listen, laugh,
and learn
with Tim and John.
I never try anything. I just do it.
Hello, everybody. I say that now because on the subways in New York, that's what they say. There's no more ladies and gentlemen.
Can I just say that's not a bad imitation?
Hello, everybody.
It's kind of neutral and almost.
Hi, everybody. Hello, everybody. That way you cover it all. It's all covered.
Thank you, Steve.
Don't worry about anything.
Garrett, you're right. I see the wrinkles clear. The pattern's fine. The pattern's working with the camera.
But I don't know. I think it blends in a little bit with the background of the San Diego skyline, don't you think, or no?
I just see the wrinkles.
You see the wrinkles?
Garrett is.
Do you iron anything?
Yeah, sure I do. But this shirt was new. I sent it out to just get clean.
Is it linen-y?
Yeah, it's linen-y. That's why
I don't think that needs to be wrinkled. I think that's a summer look.
But to Garrett's quality control issues and to Garrett in general, I go into the booth and I'm like, you know, I think this might vibrate on camera. He goes, well, I don't know about that, but it's wrinkled.
That's why we love Garrett.
That's why we love the guys in the booth, right? You get the real facts.
Right. There's facts on the ground. So there's a couple of shop talks here. John, I believe you found one of them, the first one.
Oh, yeah. It came to my inbox. Yeah.
Which is from the American Family Association. And there's an alert.
So when I used to, when I owned my ad agency and Tim was the director of marketing and advertising programs at Subaru of America, and we were doing LGBT marketing, Tim one day on the phone says to me, you know, you need to be checking out what all these other people are saying and doing about the LGBT consumer, hate groups, whatever. So I actually set up an email account. And I subscribe to these. So I still get the AFA action alert, which is hysterical. Or it makes me despondent and sad. Take your pick. But
what's fake news?
Well, now they're trying to get they're whipping up their base because Target in the headline on this of alert was Target stores are donating 100,000 to promote gay lifestyle to school children. It's a little bit of a fake news headline there, but and they said here it goes, dear friend. Yeah. According to LifeSite News, Target department stores are not only offering clothing and accessories celebrating the gay lifestyle to adults and children, but the company has also pledged to donate to a nonprofit that trains students and teachers in LGBT politics and advocacy. That is not true. That's false. Target's website has several pages dedicated to products that promote the LGBT lifestyle, many of which are specifically designed for children. For example, Target offers shirts that declare, "Love my dads," and another says, "Love my moms." Other shirts are emblazoned with the rainbow flag bearing the word pride superimposed. Now, here's where they misconstrue things. Target is donating $100,000 to the Gay, Lesbian, Straight Education Network, GLSEN, an organization whose primary focus is on indoctrinating school-age students into organizing gay clubs in public schools across the nation. That is a bald-faced lie, and if you want to swallow that one with a lump of sugar, it's still not going to go down. All GLSEN does is teach faculty and school administrators how to recognize when they have LGBT students and to help create a supportive environment for those kids so they succeed in school. That sounds a little bit different than this whole indoctrination thing, right?
Well, the whole thing is wrong. First of all, we've said this a million times to Michelangelo, being gay is not a lifestyle. Being LGBTQ is not a lifestyle.
There's
no such thing as a straight lifestyle.
Can I tell you, if I had to choose, if I were 14 or 15 again and I had to choose, if someone said, choose who you want to have sex with, the whole culture.
So the whole thing is fraught with issues. And then this really is just to whip up the base. And this is an old, you know, an old fart in the South that I think there's three or four of them in this office. That's all. But they do a good job with PR press
they
releases.
They blast this out. And they've been boycotting Target forever for the transgender bathroom thing.
So here's what we all need to do to take some action. If you call Target's headquarters, which are 612-304-6073, again, 612-304-6073 in Minneapolis, let them know that you're happy with what they're doing at Target. That's what we need to do is you need to call them and say we appreciate you recognizing pride and recognizing your LGBT customers and thank you. And that will hopefully help a little bit. But this AFA, they boycott everything. They boycott it. If you could have a sitcom.
Oh, they're upset with Trump.
There's a couple
that
would just kiss and they'd be upset because they were not married.
They're super pissed at Trump because the gay community is pissed at Trump, but they're pissed at Trump because a day or two ago, he tweeted out a message about gay pride before he went to his UK trip. And a lot of the LGBT community were very upset, how cynical, how hypocritical. But it was something like June is Gay Pride Month, whatever. They sent out a letter to all their membership saying, tell the president, how dare he support the homosexual agenda? How could he do this to us? So I thought, well, you get tarred and feathered no matter how you, no matter where you step these days, right?
So I want to go get one. I'm going to go to Target and see if they, a lot of it, I think, is online, though, isn't it? I think a lot of the
stuff. They do have some in-store merchandise, but only in select markets. But that you could buy a Pride adult gender inclusive iridescent 5-panel hat or a Pride stripe bisexual flag bandana. Pride stripe. they try to get people so worked up. Okay, what's
second,
this next
the
piece?
The second one.
It's from our home state.
Well, I think it might be England. It's not Cheshire, Connecticut, but I think it's Cheshire, England. But either way, the story's the same.
You know what, Tim? I think you're right. Yeah, you know why? Because they use the term constable.
Yeah.
Right, okay.
So the headline is, straight police recruit applies for a job during LGBTQ diversity drive, and he isn't hired. He sues and he wins. And I know there's a lot of, I know Philadelphia does it. Philadelphia does a great job of having community policing, meaning that a lot of the police in the various neighborhoods look like the people who live there. So,
because they come from the neighborhood.
If you go to Chinatown, you'll see Asian police officers. If you go to the LGBT part of town, you'll see gay and lesbian police officers and so forth. So I think
they're relatable.
Yeah, Philly's done a good job of doing that. So this is, there was a 25-year-old named Matthew Furlong. It's an unfortunate name. For gay pride, though, it fits. If you're
top
bear.
Of the pride to you, Matthew he Furlong. Wanted, top of the pride
to you.
He
wanted to follow in his dad's footsteps to become a police officer. So he applied for a job at the Cheshire Police Department during their diversity drive. And the police department wanted to hire more LGBTQ officers. And so he applied, and even though he was straight and he didn't get hired, so he sued. So my question, though, before we get into then what happened. So he sued the police department because he felt he was discriminated against because he wasn't gay and he didn't get hired. But it doesn't say in the story whether they told him that's why he wasn't offered the job. There was nowhere in there where it said, you know, we didn't hire you because you're straight. But he went ahead and he wasn't hired and just assumed it was because he wasn't.
I see where you're going. So he knew he was applying for the position during a recruitment phase specifically designed for LGBTQ officers in training. He doesn't get picked. He wants to serve on the Cheshire Constable's office because it's where he grew up and his father was in the department. And I'm going to sue because they didn't pick me because I'm straight.
He says, I applied for the job anyway. I didn't get it. He sued for discrimination. He won the case. And the Cheshire Constabulary, I don't even know how you say that, Cheshire Police Department, they reached a settlement. He's going to be joining in September. He'll be joining the force. And so this was, I guess, a case of reverse discrimination, I guess is the way you would put it. I just didn't understand how he knew he wasn't selected.
Well,
did you have to check off you were gay or lesbian?
But he does tip his hand a little bit when he says here, Furlong added that if he had lied on my interview form and said I was bisexual, then he knows he would have gotten the job and that the whole thing has completely shattered my confidence in the police force recruitment system. You are bringing up something that fascinates me because he could have applied any time during the year.
Right.
But he did it during this thing, and he actually says, if I had lied and said I was bisexual or something, I might have gotten the job. I don't know. It's weird.
So is that like and I wondered if this is similar to what's going on now with affirmative action and what's going on with all these schools where people are trying to get into colleges and saying that they're a rower or they're a soccer player or they're a tennis player and they can't get in, but if they pay or say that they could do it. It reminds me of when you and I you had sent myself into the city of Philadelphia to bid on some contract work.
Yeah, I remember that.
And we were one of the most qualified agencies to do it, but we were disqualified because we were considered minority.
That's right. That's right.
But what about capable? So you look at this sort of stuff, and I could see where you can rile up people of saying, well, if you were a minority-owned business or you're female-owned business, LGBT is not considered a minority, but sometimes it is.
You know, you bringing up the Philly thing just brings back a whole raft of memories from conversations we had about that, because I remember you went down, you and Brian from AdMark 360, we were going to pitch.
About doing all their bike lanes and bike safety in the city, and which was right up our alley.
He had experience working with Fuji.
Yep.
I think he actually did a lot of their trade materials for their racing bikes. I'm a cyclist. We have an ad agency.
We've done stuff with Gary Fisher.
But I remember you came back from that, and you were like, you guys were both nail on chalkboard, because they're like, well, you're not a minority. What a weird pocket to be falling into, right?
Well, we said, what does gay count? Nope. Does female-owned business count? Nope. So female-owned business did not count either, because his mom was actually president of, that was another one we had in there. But no, it was visible minority, I guess, in terms of
Skin color or, okay.
But that's the sort of stuff where you see where people get themselves tuned up.
Yep.
And that's how we elect Donald Trump. Happy Pride.
Happy Pride. The leprechaun's out. It's June. By the way, I woke up this morning and I'm like, how did we get to June? Do you know what I'm talking about? For our listeners,
supposed to be 40 pounds lighter, according to my polls.
Hey, you've been very...
It's still January, as far as I'm concerned.
You've been very good with your eating.
I don't think. I'm going to get gastric bypass.
No, you're not. You don't.
You're going to get a balloon in my stomach.
You don't. Well,
can you swallow a balloon? Blow it up?
Ask any parent. Kids swallow things all the time. I remember at the time I swallowed a penny. The doctor said my mom had to check every stool that came out until they found the penny. They found it a day late. I mean, I had a fast system going, but
you swallowed a penny?
I swallowed a penny. I swallowed a crayon. I swallowed a piece of Lego, one of the little 2-3
on purpose?
Brick thing. No, just playing with it. My mom did say to me, how did you swallow
Lego?
A Lego
might hurt coming out.
So I was obsessed with my Lego being clean. And so I had this little brick one time and it had this smudge
the little,
on it.
Just the little tiny one?
Two on it.
Yeah, okay.
And it had this, it was, and I licked it to do something. And I think my sister came in or something and scared me or made me laugh. And I literally breathed it in and swallowed it. And I remember the doctor, the pediatrician's like, he goes, oh, what did he swallow now? My mom's like, a piece of Lego. Ah, don't worry about it, but check the stool. It'll all come out,
She's still swallowing. Happy Pride.
Happy Pride, indeed. But honest to God, June, for our listeners, me and Tim own an advertising agency as well and a consulting firm. And most of the winter we spent working on
business,
getting a new client. But do you realize it was the whole winter? It was January to
March,
Memorial Day.
April.
Feb, March, April, and then right around Memorial Day is when we signed with the contract, which we were very excited about. But here we are in June.
Yeah.
And Tim's already got great stories coming out of Rehoboth, so at least for me. We're not going to go into those. Anyway, folks, Bob loves those stories too, by the way.
What do you like?
What was the name of the magazine they referenced?
Hi, Mark. Hi, Carl.
Because Bob said that's one. If you have to reference any magazine, that's one of them. And then I guess Honcho.
I've never heard of it.
Honcho would be another one.
I never heard of the magazine.
We had Bob and I when we first bought our place in upstate New York. An older gentleman built a house across the street from us. He was.
Oh, he probably got these.
Frankie. Ones. He was a retired hairdresser from the town next to us, which he thought of as a city, and I thought our little town was a hamlet or something. But one day.
Town and Country Hair, wasn't it?
Town and Country. I trademarked that name. No one else can use Town and Country Hair. Frank, people used to come in and say to me, Frank, can you work from a photo? I can work from any photo. This woman hands me a picture, and I said, lady, I can't touch a hair on your head till you get thousands of dollars of cosmetic surgery. And I said, Frank, what was the photo? Zsa Zsa Gabor with long hair. And this woman had hair like a pixie. So that was our across the way neighbor. One day I see him and he goes, John, I'm having a problem. Frank always had problems. And I said, what's your problem? He goes, I used to get Honcho and Freshmen and Honcho. They're delivered in brown envelopes. And they come to the mill. look at Steven. That's Honcho.
Yeah. Where did you get these things?
They're online. You can find pictures. So he says, he goes, I used to get the magazine delivered to my mailbox. I had to cut back because the subscription got expensive. So I kept Honcho, but doesn't show up. And I think the boy down the road is taking him out of my mailbox.
They still make it?
Yeah.
Is it still available?
Is that a recent issue?
ZIPPO unzipped. It says January 2000. I can't read it. January 2001.
One, it looks like.
Oh, yes.
Oh, maybe okay. Gone. Maybe it's old. Maybe it's gone.
Dirty tricks, greedy butts.
I believe it's called Mandate now.
Oh, okay. The Holes of Glory. Oh, my God.
This is almost now like that show on After Us. What was that show we were on?
Oh, Burning Bridges.
Burning Bridges now. Is it the Burning Bridges? Does they subscribe to that?
One of them does.
We should get them a subscription, yeah.
One of them does. Interesting.
I won't say which one, though.
No. Garrett is full of surprises today.
Good to know that.
Yeah, so anyway, here we are, Pride Month, and
happy
we just
Pride.
Went down. Happy Pride. The leprechaun says.
Fairy still stays with us after bashing the church, bashing the Pride. Getting dildos and leprechauns doing things.
And it's June. And we're at June already. Here
happy
we are.
Pride.
We always manage to slide into Pride Month. It's like a torrential downpour and we're sliding on the mud. Anyway, thanks for joining us. Thank you to Garrett and Steve in the booth. They bring us to you every week through the magic of their technical abilities and their sanity, which often gets questioned with us.
The flick of a switch.
Big thank you to Deep Discount. This week's release is Netflix Lost in Space, their version of it, the 2018 version, season one. Very popular. They're getting a second season on Netflix. But just to be forewarned, it's not the Dr. Smith Danger, Danger,
not
Will
the campy,
Robinson.
Not the campy.
Not the
Lost
campy.
Space.
That's the word I'm looking for. It's not the campy one. And as Tim likes
messes up
say,
every week.
To say or butcher, don't text and drive, arrive alive. I don't even need the graphic.
Is that what it says? Don't text and drive, arrive
it says,
alive.
Don't text and drive, arrive alive. Yeah. You invented it. Is that what it said? Garrett, is that what it says? I invented it. Okay. Anyway, have a safe week, everyone. We'll see you next week.
It's the Focus Group with Tim Bennett and John Nash. Accessible on all platforms. Subscribe, like, and rate us on your platform of choice. Learn more at focusgroupradio.com.
That was a stunning focus group.